All right, let's get started. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Design Thinking for Cognitive Bias, one of our Innovation Leader Speaker Series events with David Dylan Thomas. I am so thrilled that he can be here, and I'm thrilled that we've got just about 100 of you on the line so far, and I'm sure more people will be joining us. So thanks so much for coming. I have one hand raised. Hopefully you can see and hear me, but if you have a problem, please chat and we'll try to help you out. So my name is Carrie Slade. I'm the Assistant Academic Director for the Innovation and Entrepreneurship Institute, which is the institute within the Fox School of Business that puts on all this great programming. I'm also an assistant professor, and I teach a course in innovation intelligence, which is one of our courses in our Innovation Management and Entrepreneurship Master's Program. First of all, I hope it's sunny where you are. We see the sun coming out a little bit. I'd love to know where people are. So if you would just unmute yourselves for just a second. Do we have people? Who's here from Philadelphia? That's where I am. I see one hand, a couple of hands. Okay. Okay, great. And maybe you can't unmute yourself because of the setting, but that's great. I see everyone from Philadelphia. What about people from New York or New England? Do we have people from there? Okay, great. I see some hands and some chats here. Thank you. Great. Indianapolis, Toronto. Great. How about any international attendees? Anyone from abroad? We got a Florida, San Jose, Sweden. Okay, great. Ohio, Westchester, Atlanta. Okay, that's really fun. Grand Rapids, Michigan, DC. Okay, that's awesome. We are so happy to welcome you with special welcome to any IRI members and PDMA members. Those are our sponsoring organizations, as well as the Center for Student Professional Development and Fox Alumni Associations. We're really happy you could be here, and special welcome to people who are joining us for the first time for our Innovation Leader Speaker Series. Just some logistical things. Obviously you're on mute and we'll keep it that way. So we know we all have kids and dogs and other things at home right now. So if you wanna ask a question, go ahead and put up your hand. And we're also gonna use the question and answer function. So if you hover on your screen, you'll see a Q&A panel, and we can use that for questions and answers during the session and also at the end of the session. You can use the chat, but please be polite, of course, otherwise we'll have to remove you. And we are recording this, just so you know, so we can share it with you afterwards, and so you can share it with other people and spread the content around. So one of the reasons we have these Innovation Leader Speaker Series is really to showcase the principles and practices around innovation that we at Temple believe and that we teach our students. So these and other programs kind of highlight some topics that we teach in our academic programs. And I wanted to just get a couple of announcements out of the way, because I think we're gonna be, have a lot of questions for David at the end. So I just wanna make a couple of announcements about our programs. We have a couple of different options for graduate programs. If you're, kind of feeling like you don't know what to do with yourself, maybe you're staying home, maybe your career's gotten disrupted, but you've always been interested in innovation and entrepreneurship, now might be an ideal time for you to invest in yourself and go back to school. We have scholarships, we have GMAT and GRE waivers. If you have work experience, you may not need to take any standardized tests. You can start with a single course too, and you could turn that into a 3-credit certificate or a full master's degree in innovation management and entrepreneurship. So here's some information on the slide. You can also scan that QR code and that'll give you some more information, and always feel free to contact me as well. Here's some upcoming courses that we have starting just about in a month or two. Business Model Innovation with Dr. Robert McNamee, talking about how you can adapt and innovate your business model, especially now when innovation has never been more important. And Creativity Unleashed, harnessing creativity to solve real-world innovation challenges. This is with our adjunct professor, Michelle Histand, who is the Director of Innovation at Independence Blue Cross. And some of you may know this event was originally scheduled to be in person at Blue Cross, and we will still have that event, but because of everything, we had to move it online. Hold on one second, because I hear my son is banging up. Okay, sorry about that. So both of these classes are upcoming. They're both at night. They're both online. So you can do your entire master's degree or certificate online if you want to. And if you're interested in either of those, you know, feel free to reach out to me at any time. So I wanted to introduce the topic a little bit. What does innovation have to do with design thinking and cognitive bias? And I think when I was looking at innovation definitions, you know, an innovation is a noun. It's a thing like an iPhone or, you know, a ventilator, or what they're doing now to kind of jerry-rig the ventilator to serve more than one person. That in and of itself is an innovation. But innovation, if you look at the definition, it's also a process, the act of innovating, the process of innovative. So there's something about innovation that requires a process. And I think we all intuitively know that innovation, the process can either promote innovation and make it better, or the process can detract from innovation and, you know, make it so something isn't really that creative and innovative. So the process of innovation is just as important as the end result, the product or service that you're trying to create. And even if some of you are familiar with design thinking, the first step in that design thinking process is customer empathy. And empathy is really about understanding the minds of your customers. What are they thinking about and how do they think? And by the same token, it's hard to have empathy if you don't understand the way you think and the way your mind processes information. So David's insights into cognitive bias really relate to the process of innovation. How can we make sure that process is free from bias, is equitable, and actually produces the best products and services for the customers that you're trying to serve? So without further ado, let me introduce David. David Dylan Thomas is a content strategy advocate at Think Company, which is a design and software development firm here in Philadelphia. He's also the creator of the Cognitive Bias podcast, which I highly recommend. I've been listening to it. The episodes are pretty short, and in each episode, he talks about one cognitive bias to kind of explicate what that cognitive bias is about. So I highly recommend that. That's available on iTunes, and you can also get that for Android as well. And I can't say enough of nice things about David. I literally contacted him out of the blue through a mutual connection. I asked him to do an event with us. He said yes. And then when the in-person event was canceled, he said, you know, I still want to do something. I still want to get this content and this knowledge out there. So he's just been great to work with. And I'm really excited for this presentation. And I'm so happy all of you could join us. So David, please take it away.
Thanks so much. And thanks for the kind words. It's been great working with you too. Hello, everybody. I'm going to grab the screen here real quick. Just a moment. Oops, that's the very end. Spoiler alert, you just saw the last slide. Here we go. That's better. I'm hoping everyone can see my screen right now. So yeah, let's get started. Thanks for coming out. So today we're going to talk about design thinking for cognitive bias, using mental shortcuts for good instead of evil. If you want to learn how to use them for evil, that's a different discussion we can have. But today we're going to talk about using them for good. If you like to tweet while you watch these things, the hashtag for this is Fight Bias. As Carrie said, my name is David Dylan Thomas. I'm the content strategy advocate at Think Company. I'm also the creator and host of the Cognitive Bias podcast. And I want to talk a little bit about how I came to be hosting that podcast. A few years ago, I saw a talk by Iris Bonnet called Gender Equality by Design. It's a great talk. I highly recommend that you find it on YouTube and watch it. I wouldn't be offended if you did that right now. It's a far better talk than my talk. But one of the things she was talking about is this notion that some of the things that we rail against and that are, you know, hurtful, like gender bias or racial bias, really come down to not always someone who is actively consciously hateful and actively consciously doesn't like Black people or doesn't like women. But very often it can come down to pattern recognition. And what she meant by that, think about someone who's hiring a web developer, right? And the picture in their head, as soon as they think web developer, might be a skinny white dude. And it's because they actually think that white people are better, or males are better at development than women or people of color. If you ask them that, they deny it, but the pattern that's been set up in their heads from TV, from people they've seen in their office, sort of makes that equation. And so if they see a name at the top of a resume that doesn't match skinny white dude for them, without even thinking about it, they start giving that resume a side eye, and it can affect the future of that resume. So when I learned that something as pernicious as a racial or gender bias can come down to something as simple and, dare I say, human as pattern recognition, I decided I needed to learn everything I possibly could about cognitive bias. And so I did. This is a page from the Rational Wiki website, the page for cognitive biases, and there's over 100 of them. And I took one look at that and realized, okay, I'm not gonna figure this all out in a day. So I did one a day. I looked at one bias a day and just learned what I could about it, moved on to the next one. And this turned me into the guy who wouldn't shut up about cognitive bias. So my friends were eventually like, Dave, please just get a podcast. And so I did. So let's talk a little about what is cognitive bias. Basically, it's a series of shortcuts your mind is making. You have to make something like a trillion decisions a day. Right. Even right now, I'm making decisions about how fast to talk, where to avert my gaze, how, you know, what to do with my hands. Right. And if I had to think consciously about every single one of those decisions, I would never get anything done. So most of our lives are spent on autopilot. And that's generally a good thing. And occasionally, though, those shortcuts will lead us into error. And we call those errors biases. So a really fun one is called illusion of control. So if you have to roll a die, and you need to roll a really high number to win, you'll roll the die really hard. If you need a really low number to win, you'll roll it really gently. And we all know it makes no difference, right, how hard we throw the die, but we like to think we have control over situations we don't have control over. I think everyone's feeling that right now. And so we embody that desire for control by how hard we throw the die. Another one that I think is really interesting to think about from a design perspective is called survivorship bias. And it's when you think about the winners, but kind of ignore the losers. And a good illustration of this is the story of a guy named Abraham Wald. Abraham Wald was a refugee in World War II. He left Austria right when the Nazis moved in. So he was living in America, and he was a really smart mathematician, had his PhD, and they had him go to work on helping them figure out where do we put the armor on planes so they don't get shot down so much, right? And so they had a whole bunch of planes in the room and a whole bunch of scientists. And most of the scientists looked at the planes and said, hey, you should put more armor where the bullet holes are, right? Makes perfect sense. Abraham looked at those planes and said, no, you need to put them exactly where the bullet holes aren't. Because he realized the planes in that room were planes that made it back. They needed to be looking at the planes that got shot down so bad that they could never make it back. Those were the ones that needed more armament. And clearly they were shot where these planes weren't, right? So the people in the room were thinking about the survivors. He was thinking about the ones who didn't make it. And I learned a really early lesson in this in design. My first design job, I was content strategist on a project for a website. And the first thing out of the gate, we did the homepage. And I thought we had a great homepage. It looked beautiful, right? I thought the client is gonna love this. And the client did not love this. We went through like three or four more versions before we finally settled on something that actually went live. And I realized in that moment, wait a minute, how many websites do I see every single day that are like the fifth or sixth choice? How much of the built world around us is actually what got through committee, what people could afford, what the manager signed off on, right? Like the world built around us wasn't sort of sprung from the mind of Athena. No, it was just what people could agree on. And I think that's an important lesson for us as designers, is to realize that the built world we live on is not some like perfect, you know, representation of what was originally intended. More often than not, it's just what a lot of people were able to figure out. A bias that I think we're all familiar with is called confirmation bias. And it's exactly what you think it is. You get an idea in your head, and no matter what, you're convinced it's true, and you will look for evidence to confirm that idea. And if you ever see anything that goes against that idea, you just say fake news and you move on. One of the most powerful examples of this came after the Iraq War. So the whole premise of the Iraq War was Saddam Hussein has weapons of mass destruction. We need to go in there and stop him. Made perfect sense. As it turned out, not so much with the weapons of mass destruction. And even, I think it was only 1 year. So by 2004, President George W. Bush, who had been saying forever that there were weapons of mass destruction there, he was already saying by 2004, yeah, there's nothing there. Cut to 2015, and 51% of Republicans still believed, actually 53% of Republicans still believed that there were weapons of mass destruction in Iraq, and 36% of Democrats, right? This was a firm idea. And people who watched Fox News, about 51% of them believed that there were still weapons of mass destruction, even in 2015. And again, they were viewing content that confirmed their bias and ignoring any content that didn't. So we're going to come back to confirmation bias because it's really important. Now, these are really hard to fight. One of the problems with fighting bias is that you may not even know you have the bias, right? There's even a bias called the bias blind spot, where you think you don't have any biases, but you're sure everybody else does. Part of the reason they're so hard to spot is that something like 95% of cognition happens below the conscious level. I'm actually writing a book about this called Design for Cognitive Bias. And in studying the book, I used to say it was 90%, but when I did the research, I found out it's actually 95%. So 95% of your cognition is happening in a place where you don't even realize it's happening, right? So anytime somebody asks you why you did something, the most honest answer you can give is, how the hell should I know? Even in that 5%, right? Even if you know you have the bias, you'll probably still do it anyway. There's a bias called anchoring. And the way it works is I could ask everybody on this call to write down the last two numbers of their social security number. And after that, I could say, hey, we're all going to go to eBay and bid on this bottle of wine. If the last two numbers you wrote down were high, you'd bid higher for the bottle of wine. If the last two numbers you wrote down were lower, you'd bid lower, right? It's anchoring. It's a thing. Here's the thing. I could tell you before we begin the experiment, hey, there's this thing called anchoring, and I'm going to have you write this thing down, and then you're going to bid. Don't do that. Don't let it influence you. They'll still do it, but it gets even worse. I could say, hey, here's this thing called anchoring, and I will pay you cash money not to do it. Still do it. The reason we as designers, or even just anybody who makes things, have to be very, very conscious of bias is a thing called choice architecture, right? And choice architecture can be demonstrated by what happens when you go to the store, right? Usually, you know, when you're getting produce, to not pick from the top of the pile, right? Because the grocer typically will put the produce they're trying to move and get rid of at the top of the pile, and that's the older stuff, right? The savvy shopper knows to dig deeper, right? That choice, right, is architected to benefit the grocer, right? Because the grocer knows that most people are lazy and will just reach for the thing that's right in front of them. It could just as easily be designed or architected to benefit the shopper. And put the nice, you know, produce at the top because it's the easiest produce to reach. It's the one you're most likely to reach for. When we're designing things, right, we need to think about the decisions our users need to make. Because that's kind of the business that we're in, is helping people make decisions. But then we need to think about how people make decisions, not how a rational person makes decisions, because there's almost never any such thing. And again, 95% of the time, your user is making decisions without even thinking about it. As it turns out, there are, in fact, content and design choices we can make that can help keep harmful cognitive biases at bay or perhaps use them for good. And that's what we're going to talk about today. So let's go back to that skinny white dude, right? As it turns out, you can have two identical resumes. And the only difference is the name at the top. And if it's a male-dominated field, if the name at the top of the resume is male, it is more likely to move up the chain. If it is not, it is likely to just stay in the pile. And study after study after study has shown this. They've even seen that if people who are of color whiten, quote unquote, their resumes to remove any notions of blackness from the resume, right? Even that can actually improve their odds. So here's a question then. Why do we need that information? If you're the hiring manager, what is the name telling you that helps you decide whether or not to hire that person? Think of it as a content strategy problem, signal versus noise. The signal, the thing that's going to help you make the decision, are the qualifications, the experience, right? The things that are actually going to get in the way of that are the gender or the race, or what you're reading into the gender or the race based on the name. So the city of Philadelphia did in fact try this out. They did blind screening for a web developer position. And they learned a couple things pretty quickly. One is that the best way to blind a resume, even in the high-tech world of web development, is to have an intern who has no stake in the hiring process physically print out the resume and then take a magic marker and then just redact it like a CIA document. The other thing they found out is that when it came time to actually look at a resume and look and see qualifications they liked, the next thing you would do is go to GitHub. And GitHub, for those of you who don't know, is a code repository. And you can think of it as a place where a web developer might keep their portfolio. It would be a natural thing to do to say, I'm interested in this web developer. Let me see what they have on GitHub. So imagine what happens the second that they go to that that person's profile on GitHub. All of the personal information is there, right? And it ruins the experiment. So what they did was they created a plugin for Chrome, a little program that as that page loaded would redact all of the personal identifying information. And then just to close the loop, they took that code and they put it on GitHub so that anybody can use it. So if you want to try this yourself, it's right there on GitHub now. This isn't just about helping human people hire. Amazon a few years ago had a hiring bot that basically its job was to help hiring managers figure out who to hire and make recommendations. I want you all to sit down here, tell you a little shocking truth. Turned out it was a little bit sexist. It was so sexist that it would look and see if there was a name of a women's college on the resume, it would downvote it. So it was like aggressively sexist. So they went and they tried to figure out, okay, what is with this AI? And they said, what did we train this AI on? Because that's what you do when you're trying to figure out what an AI is doing. It gets trained on data. That's how it makes decisions. The data they trained it on was the last 5-10 years of resumes. And guess what all those resumes had in common, right? Most of them were from men. So the AI took one look at that, said, oh, you sure must like dudes, and then just kept recommending dudes. So we need to be very careful when we're creating the training data for these AIs to not simply reflect the world we have, but reflect the world we want. In fact, I'm a proponent of just straight up lying to AI and saying, okay, we're gonna pretend like the job field is actually perfectly even for women and men right now. In fact, I'm gonna over-optimize. I'm gonna show you more female resumes than male resumes just because I know if I just show you the way the world is, you're just gonna scale that. Now, this can go in both directions. So Amazon Go is a store where you basically walk in, take what you like, put it in your cart, and leave. You don't pay for anything in the store. Amazon automatically just deducts it from your account, which means there's not really any service staff. There's no clerks. So Ashley Clark Thompson wrote an article about this describing what a unique experience it was for her because she was used to something called Shopping While Black. And for those of you who haven't experienced it, it's kind of like super aggressive customer service. Can I help you? No. Can I help you? No, really, can I help you? Right? So it's customer service that turns into microaggressions and they kind of follow you around the store. Well, there was no one at Amazon Go to do this. So from a service design perspective, they had eliminated the one design element that could cause bias. We're also seeing this play out in the criminal justice system. So last summer, City of San Francisco tried an experiment where they would remove the racial, gender, and location elements of different crimes and crime reports. And the reason they did this is because the way the criminal justice system works, the district attorney doesn't necessarily charge everybody, right? They actually have leeway to say, we're gonna charge this person, we're not gonna charge that person. They have incredible leeway with this. And they found that, again, big shock, people of color were being charged way more often than white people. And as an experiment, they said, okay, well, let's take that blind resume approach to crime reports. Again, what about that information is helping the DA make a decision about who to charge? So let's eliminate it completely. It's still a little early, and if anybody on the call is from San Francisco and knows how this is going, please let me know. I'm having trouble finding the follow-up information for it, but this was something they tried out in San Francisco starting last summer. I want to talk for a bit about something called cognitive fluency, and this has a huge impact on design. Basically, the principle is that if something is easy to read, if it looks like it's going to be easy to read, I will assume that whatever it's talking about is also easy to do. Similarly, if I'm looking at something and it seems like it's going to be hard to read, I will assume whatever it's talking about is really hard to do. So I love pancakes. If there was a way to make virtual pancakes, I would make them for all of us and pass them out. I had pancakes this morning. This is a recipe for pancakes. And it's kind of clumped together, right? There's not a lot of spacing. It's kind of hard to scan. And I take a look at that. And I haven't read a single word yet, but already I'm assuming pancakes are probably hard to make. I don't know if I want to make pancakes. If I see something with really big photos and just small chunks of text, before I start, I think, oh, that's going to be easy to read. I bet pancakes aren't that hard to make. A 2-minute video? Forget it. We're making pancakes. Now take a look at these two ways of finding out how to use public transportation to get from Media, where I live, to downtown Philadelphia, right? If I look at the one on the left, I am immediately convinced I should drive, right? There's no way I want to try to figure out. I take a look at that and I think it is going to be impossible to use public transportation to get from one part of town to the other. On the right is a SEPTA app. It's the app for train and bus service in Philadelphia. I take one look at that and I think, I bet it's not going to be that hard to use public transportation. Let me try this out. So we can't really do this in real time, but ask yourself personally, right? Which of these two do you think is true? Rosa Parks was born in 1912 or Rosa Parks was born in 1914? So take a moment, decide for yourself. If you are like most people, you picked 1914. By the way, you're both wrong. She was born in 1913, but most people end up picking 1914. And the reason is if things are easier to read, we think they're more true. It gets worse. If something rhymes, we actually think it is more true. And this has consequences, right? So what's going on here? We love certainty and we hate uncertainty. That's one thing I've learned by looking at bias after bias after bias. All of them are trying to get you closer to certainty. And we will throw logic under the bus, we will throw other people under the bus to get to certainty and get away from uncertainty. And things that rhyme, things that are easy to read are easier to process. Things that are easier to process feel more certain. An example might be if I were to ask you, what did you get for your 5th birthday, right? You might not be that sure. It's hard to process. And I might say, oh, you got a truck, right? Little toy truck. And you wouldn't really be sure if that was true. Because again, it's hard to remember, it's hard to process. If I were to ask you what you had for breakfast this morning, you'd be pretty confident in your answer, right? It happened recently, it's easy to remember, it's easy to process. Things that rhyme are easy to process. Things that are easier to remember. Things that are easy to read are easier to process. We equate easy to process with true. And that's what's happening here. Now, this becomes really important when it comes to things we need to believe are true. Right now, right, we're talking about how important it is for people to actually believe it's important to social distance, right? Here's another example. African Americans in this country rarely believe health information that comes from the government, right? So this is a survey from 2002 in response to the statement, the government usually tells the truth about major health issues like HIV/AIDS. The response rate among African Americans was only 37% of African Americans agreed with that statement. By the time you get to 2016, that number drops to 18%, right? Now, we could have a whole other webinar about why there are legit reasons the African American community has a distrust of health information coming from the government, but this is information that could save lives, right? So whatever we need to do, whether it's rhyming, whether it's plain language, whether it's, you know, big bold fonts, we need to try it. And there is, in fact, medical evidence around this. So this is from one study. Pregnant smokers and ex-smokers who received a specially designed intervention with materials written at the third grade reading level were more likely to achieve abstinence during pregnancy and 6 weeks postpartum than those who received standard materials, right? So these are people who were smoking while they were pregnant, right, and after. And the idea is if the material was delivered in a way that was easier to process, people were actually more likely to stop smoking and keep from smoking after they had their children. Another example, a plain language pictogram-based intervention used as part of medication counseling resulted in decreased medication dosing errors and improved adherence among multi-ethnic, low socioeconomic status caregivers whose children were treated at an urban pediatric emergency department. Again, that combination of pictogram and plain language, right, easy to process, meant that you had fewer dosing errors and improved adherence. And anybody who's done work in public health knows that adherence, actually taking the drugs you've gotten, as hard as it is to actually get them, then actually taking it, is a huge problem in the medical industry. So any needle, anywhere you can move the needle on that is huge. So you're saying, yeah, Dave, I buy it. Plain language, fine. Pictograms, great. But there's no way that rhyming actually saves lives. Let me present you with Click It or Ticket. And again, this is one of those things I found out when I actually, it's really great to have to write a book about the thing you've been giving a talk about, because then you actually have to be much more certain about your sources, right? And so my wonderful editor pushed me on this and said, yeah, I get it in theory, but can you actually find an instance where rhyming saved lives? And I started digging, and yeah. So I don't know how many of you remember Click It or Ticket. This was a program that was rolled out, I think in the 2000s, around seatbelt safety, right? Like, people weren't buckling their seatbelts. So they created a legal precedent, right, where it's like, okay, now it's a crime, or actually you'll get a ticket if you don't actually have your seatbelt buckled. And that did a really good job of getting people to buckle up, but mostly older people. Younger people still weren't doing it as much. So they rolled out Click It or Ticket, this rhyming campaign. It was a whole media thing. And they found the results were that national belt use among young men and women ages 16 to 24 moved from 65% to 72% and 73% to 80% respectively, right? And this is a big deal, because the other thing I found out is that for every percentage point that you increase people actually buckling up, 270 lives are saved, right? So that's like 4,000 lives that were saved through rhyming. And the plain language aspect of this is actually federal law, right? So there's this thing called the Federal Plain Language Act of, I think, 2010. The guidelines came out in 2011. And it basically says, look, if you are a website that's receiving federal funds to provide services, you better be talking about those services using plain language. And I highly recommend actually looking this up. 18F is an organization that has fantastic plain language guidelines. Even if you're not in government service, they're great to look at just to understand how to talk to people. Another weird phenomenon about easy to process is how we equate visual things to stuff that has nothing to do with visual things. So if you have an item that's on sale, right, usually what you do is you have the sale price, and then you have the original price slashed out somewhere near it. Here's the thing. If you actually move the sale price further away from the original price, I will think it's a better deal, even if it's the exact same deal. We equate the visual distance with actual price distance. Weirdly, this only works horizontally. If I were to move them vertically further apart, it wouldn't make any difference. Another easier to process thing is something called the name pronunciation effect, right? And this is where the names that are easier to pronounce, and again, easy to pronounce is based on the culture you're in. So in America, John is easier to pronounce. In other countries, Mabimu is easier to pronounce. But if your name in that culture is easier to pronounce, you will do better. People will think better of you. And this extends to political races, right? My favorite example of this is they looked at law firms. And law firms, as you went higher up the ranks in the law firm, the names got easier to pronounce. The craziest one of these is stocks. So if you're, you know, having an IPO, if your stock is about to go public, if the name of your stock is easier to pronounce, it will do better. If even the stock ticker, right, little abbreviation is easier to pronounce, it will do better, right? So OFO there is gonna do better than Jerdy over there. Another thing to think about is hierarchy, visual hierarchy. So there's this bias called primacy, and it has to do with how, if I give you a list of things to remember, you will remember the things at the beginning and the end of that list more than the stuff in the middle. And Amazon ran into this with their reviews. So it used to be Amazon reviews, the most recent review would be first. And people would assume, oh, that must be the most authoritative review because it's at the top of the page, because we're simple creatures. But in fact, that had nothing to do with why it was at the top of the page. So they created this thing called helpfulness, right? And for each review, you could say this was or wasn't helpful. And they put the most helpful review at the top of the page, which is better, But people would look at a helpful review, and if it was positive, they'd assume, oh, it was a great product. If it was negative, oh, they'd assume, oh, this must be a terrible product. So they started putting the most helpful positive review right next to the most helpful critical review, right? This gave them both equal visual weight, which forced you, the user, to give them both equal critical weight. Another bias that you see a lot of is called the bandwagon effect. And it's exactly what you think it is. If a whole bunch of people are doing something, you assume that you should be doing it too. And a great example of this is an experiment where you get a bunch of people in a room and you say, okay, here's exhibit one, take a look at that. Now, A, B, or C, which one of those lines is most like exhibit one, right? And if you sit down one-on-one with somebody and you show them this, they'll say, oh, A, right? But that's not what I do. I put you in a room with 12 other people and you go last. And before we get to you, all 12 people say B, right? So that by the time I get to you, you say B, right? And they would talk to people afterwards and they would say, I wasn't sure if I misunderstood the question. I figured they knew something I didn't know. The really important thing to know about the bandwagon effect is that it's fairly easy to diffuse. If there's even one other person in the room who says A, you now have the confidence to say A. You're much more likely to say A. So if you're doing some kind of design exercise, for example, where you have a bunch of people in a room and you have to get their honest opinion, don't have them just raise their hands, right? Because if someone says something like, oh, I think that's a great design, right? And two or three people say that, that third person who doesn't think it's a great design might not say anything. In fact, if the first person to raise their hand is like the most powerful person in the room and they say it's a great design, nobody else is gonna say it's not a good design, right? Whereas if you were to say, okay, we're gonna say whether or not what we think of this design, write down your answers on stickies, right? And you write down those answers on stickies and then you just gather them all up and start to aggregate. Okay, a few people here said this, a few people here said that. You are much more likely to get an honest opinion and people in the room can see, oh, I'm not the only one who thought that wasn't a great design, and they feel more empowered to speak. The most dangerous bias in the world, in my opinion, is the framing effect. And it starts out harmless enough. Imagine you go to a store and you see a sign that says beef 95% lean, right? And next to that, you see a sign that says beef 5% fat. Which one do you think is gonna sell better? It's the same thing. It is exactly the same thing, but I framed it differently to make it seem more or less appetizing. Now, this is all good and well when we're talking about meat, but what if I were to say, should we go to war in April or should we go to war in May? See what I did there? We're no longer discussing whether or not it's a good idea to go to war in the first place. And believe me, wars have been started over less. Now, I don't know how many of you are bilingual, multilingual, can speak more than one language, but if you do, you have an advantage. If you can think about the decision in your non-native language, you are much less likely to fall for the scam. So I speak a little bit of French. So if I were to do the beef decision, I would think, okay, beef, that's boeuf. Wow, that's a lot of vowels. 95%, that's 89, maybe, right? And so by the time I did all of that processing, I would see right through the illusion. And that's really what a lot of bias is. It's just thinking too fast. Daniel Kahneman wrote a book called Thinking Fast and Slow, which is like the Bible of cognitive bias. Again, highly recommend you read it. But his basic premise is that when we're thinking really fast, right, we skip over all these logical traps. If we can slow down our thinking, right, we usually don't fall for a lot of these things. Now, framing can actually be used for good. So there's an experiment where you show an audience a photo of a senior citizen behind the wheel of a car, and you ask them, should this person drive this car? And what you'll get is a policy discussion, right? You'll have some people saying, oh my God, old people are bad at everything, don't let them drive. And you'll have other people saying, that's so ageist, people should do what they want, right? And all you will learn by the end of that conversation is who's on what side. Now, you can show the exact same photo to another audience and ask them, how might this person drive this car? And what you will get is a design discussion. And what you will learn by the end of that is several different ways that person might be able to drive that car. Oh, what if we moved the steering wheel? What if we changed the shape of the dashboard? You can go even further, right? What if I frame it as, how might we do a better job of moving people around, right? Because that's why the person was in the car in the first place. They were here and they wanted to be there. And if I frame it this way, now we can talk about things like public transportation. All of that changed by simply changing the frame of the conversation. That first change was just two words in the question, right? But how we frame it greatly impacts the conversation we end up having. Another instance of the framing effect is, and this is going to hit close to home for some of y'all at Temple, but at universities around the country, around the world, generally speaking, when people do evaluations, student evaluations of courses, tend to be very gender biased. Women tend to perform less well in those. They tend to get rated lower than their male counterparts, just across the board. So at the, I think it's the University of Iowa, they tried out an experiment and they said, okay, for some of the people who are getting these evaluations, we're gonna have just a couple sentences, a little blur beforehand that basically says that, hey, you're about to fill out a student evaluation for your course. Just know that generally speaking, women and their courses tend to get rated lower. People of color tend to get rated lower. So please make sure that when you are, you know, filling this out, you're filling it out fairly. Like language that basically said that. The people who got that frame tended to rate women and people of color in their courses higher than people who did not. So I want to close by talking about our own cognitive biases. And these are actually the most dangerous for our users because there's the ones that we don't even realize that we have. One of the first ones I want to talk about is called notational bias. And it's a bias where you take the way you see the world and you kind of infuse that in the structures you create and the things that you write and the way you write things. So for a long time, I played saxophone as a kid growing up, and I had to learn sheet music just like this. And I thought that this Western notation was, in fact, the way you would write all music. Like, I thought there was no music in the world that you couldn't capture using this. This is how it's done. 30 years later, I found out that's not even a little bit true, that there's all sorts of Asian and African music that you could never represent using this pattern. And if you make this the default, you erase so many cultures. We see this more commonly today when we're asking for personal information, right? So if I'm writing a form that's asking for personal information, and the way I see the world is there's only male and female, and I write the form that way, I'm going to be eliminating so many identities, right? And by the way, when we are talking about personal information, we need to be very careful how often we ask for it. So there's a thing called the self-serving bias. And the way it works is if something went well, that's my fault. If something went poorly, that's your fault. And typically with computers, that's how we are, right? If the computer, something goes wrong with like an online transaction, I will blame the computer unless I have given that computer a lot of personal information. The more personal information I give that computer, the more likely I am to blame myself if something goes wrong and blame the computer if something goes right. Because we treat computers like people, right? Who else do we share personal information with? Friends, close friends. So we start to treat the computer like a close friend. So every time we ask users for personal information, we are potentially engendering an unhealthy relationship with that computer. So we need to be very thoughtful about when we decide we absolutely need that information. Another notational bias thing that every time I bring up the slide, it kind of breaks my heart. Until 1986, the New York Times prohibited the use of Ms. as an honorific for women, right? And the way this worked was for its entire history up to 1986, if you mentioned a woman's name in an article, at the first mention of her name, you would have her full name, and then at every subsequent mention of her name, it would be Miss last name or Mrs. last name. No such restriction for men, it would be Mr., which tells you nothing about their marital status. So think about that, year after year after year after year, right? And article after article after article, the most important thing to know about a woman is whether or not she's married and then maybe her last name. That's the message that that structured content kept sending over and over and over again, right? It's a very strong notational bias. And not only does it sort of set you up to think that way, right, and be forced to see that information in that order, it also starts to normalize it and make you think, even when you're not reading the New York Times, oh, there's a woman, I wonder if she's married, right? Like, it's a pattern. And we've talked before about how important patterns are. So again, we need to be very careful with the editorial guidelines with we create, the way we structure content, that we're not scaling some horrible bias. As Mbibu Gogomu, this guy works at IBM once said, language doesn't just describe reality, it shapes it. And this is the legal truth. If you look back at Bush's presidency, when Dick Cheney came into power, his lawyers told him, okay, look, you are the vice president, therefore you are part of the executive branch, right? Makes sense. But you also cast the tie-breaking vote in the Senate, so technically you're also in the legislative branch. But you can't be in the executive branch and the legislative branch. So maybe you're not in either. And if you're not in either, maybe you don't have to submit to the rules of either. And he didn't, right? And we see the same thing today with things like Facebook, where when it suits them, Facebook is a publisher. Hey, New York Times, come publish with us. We're awesome. But when they start to realize that there are rules for publishers, they say, whoa, I don't know what people told you, but we're a platform, not a publisher. Now, there are tools out there to help you think through how to solve some of these problems. And I'll be sending out, I'm gonna give you a resources sheet that you can kind of send out to people afterwards. So you don't have to like screenshot every single one of these. but one of them is called Radical Copy Editor. And they do a really good job of helping you think about how do you write for and about people who usually don't get much say in how they're written about, right? And they give you some great resources for thinking about sort of more inclusive writing. Another good one is Textio. And they do a lot of work, but one of the things they specialize in is helping you write resumes that are more inclusive, because not everybody wants to be a ninja or a rock star. So they can kind of scan your resumes for that kind of language. Now, one thing that I really want to talk about today is evidentiality, right? It's this thing that English lacks, but lots of other languages have. And evidentiality is basically a really clever way to use your verb tense. In English, verb tense really just tells you when something happened, right? Bob went to the store, Bob is going to the store, Bob will go to the store, right? Other languages make their verb tenses do a little bit more heavy lifting. They use their, I think Turkish is one of them, they use their verb tense to not only tell you when something happened, but to also tell you how you know it happened. So it's one verb tense for, I personally saw Bob go to the store. There's another verb tense for, somebody told me Bob went to the store. And there's a whole other verb tense for, like, I don't know, I read on the internet, Bob went to the store, right? So you can't tell somebody anything without also telling them how you know it happened, right? And imagine how useful that would be today, right? In English, to be on the hook for, oh, I'm gonna post this thing to the internet and I can't post it without also telling you how I know it's true. It is something that English lacks, but there are, I think, design tricks we can use to introduce it into English. So remember how we were saying that if something's easy to read, it's more believable? Well, it goes in reverse too. The harder something is to read, the less believable it's gonna be. So this is an actual article from when the first teaser trailer for the new James Bond movie dropped. And the first paragraph, right, is based on verifiable facts. This is the name of the movie, this is who's in it. The second paragraph is literally about a rumor about why the first director was kicked off the set. The first paragraph is pretty easy to read. The second paragraph is hard to read and therefore harder to believe, and it should be, it's a rumor. And I think there are ways we can play with fonts and with design to help communicate the believability of things. And I challenge all of us to start working on this. The New York Times, actually, if you get their app, you'll notice that the opinions headlines are written in a completely different typography than the real articles. Weirdly, they don't do that on the website, so I don't know if they've completely gotten the message, but anyway. Confirmation bias. I told you we were gonna come back to this. So I'm gonna tell you a quick story about how I got the scientific method wrong. I used to think that the scientific method was, I have an idea about how the world works and I'm gonna test that idea. And if I'm right, I'm gonna have you test it and you test it and you test it. And if we all get the same answer, great. Let's move on to the next thing to test. Not actually how it works. After talking to some real scientists, I learned that it's more like this. I have an idea about the way the world works and I'm gonna test that. And if I get a result I like, I'm gonna have you test and you test and you test. And if we all get results we like, great. I get to spend the rest of forever trying to prove myself wrong, right? I have to think, if I'm wrong, what else might be true? Let me go and test that, which is a much more rigorous way of going about it and is designed specifically to fight confirmation bias. And as designers, it's really easy for us to leave good design on the table through this very process. And I'll give you an example. Let's say we're gonna play a game, and the game is the computer is gonna show you these numbers and you get to put in any number you want where the question mark is. After you do that, you hit enter and the computer will tell you whether or not that number fits the pattern. Put as many numbers in there as you like. When you think you know what the pattern is, let me know, right? So if you're like me, you see this and the first thing you try is 8, right? And I ask the computer, and the computer says, congratulations, that fits the pattern. Would you like to try another number? If you're like me, you say, nope, hold my beer. And I say, the pattern is even numbers. And the computer says, you're wrong. And the reason I'm wrong is because I didn't try this. The pattern is not even numbers. The pattern is every number is higher than the number that came before it, right? Which is a much more elegant pattern, much easier to code. But I left that wonderful, elegant pattern on the table because I was so in love with my even numbers idea. And we do this all the time. Let's say we come up with a content strategy or a design that we love, or God forbid our client loves, before we've really investigated whether there's something better out there. We are gonna be stuck with that inferior thing. Now, there are in fact exercises and methods to help fight that. And one of them is called a red team, blue team. And it's a method that both the military uses and journalists. And I defy you to come up with a list longer than two of things that both the military and journalists use. But the way it works is you have a blue team, and that blue team is gonna do the initial research and the initial design thinking around the solution. And they might get as far as, like, say, wireframes. They might be ready to do a prototype, but before they get there, the red team comes in for one day. And the red team's job is to go to war with the blue team. They're there to figure out every missed opportunity, every design flaw, and everything that might be harmful that they overlooked because the blue team was so in love with their initial idea, right? And what I like about this solution is that it's fairly cost-effective. I don't have to go to my COO and say, hey, guess what? From now on, for every project, we gotta spin up two teams and they gotta check each other's work every single day. No, I just need one team for one day to come in and check and make sure we're not putting something harmful out into the world. Another really fun approach for finding those flaws is called speculative design. And I don't know how many of you ever watched the show Black Mirror, but Black Mirror is basically like the Twilight Zone, but for tech. So you come up with some near future algorithm or technology, and you see how would that actually play out in the real world with real human beings. The way the showrunner puts it, it's powerful technology in the hands of weak people. And usually the outcome is like horrible. And I think that anybody working on a new technology by law should be required to write a Black Mirror episode about it. But one of my favorite instances of this, because this is an actual business, is the folks at Superflux went to the United Arab Emirates. They were asked to come in there and help them think through the future of energy, right? Because they were making big decisions about, do we continue down the path of fossil fuels? Do we try to invest in renewables? And so what Superflux did was they sort of conceived of the world of the United Arab Emirates in 2028, 2034, like in the future. And as part of that, they said, well, what is your air quality gonna be like, right? They had the data to sort of predict what the air quality was gonna be like then, but they did more than just predict it. They bottled it, and then they made them breathe it. And by the time you get to like 2038, it is unbreathable. And causation or correlation, but at the end of that conference, they announced, yeah, we're gonna invest something like $150 billion with a B in renewables. The last bias I wanna talk about is called déformation professionnelle. Told you I speak French. And it's basically the idea that you see the world through the lens of your job, which in the workaholic society we have, you know, kind of seems to make sense until it doesn't. So the paparazzi who ran Princess Di off the road probably thought they were doing an amazing job. And technically speaking, they were, right? They were getting really difficult to get photographs that were gonna fetch them a whole lot of money. But what they weren't doing a good job of was being human beings, right? When the police commissioner, former police commissioner of Philadelphia first got the job, he asked his officers, hey, what do you think your job is? And many of them would say to enforce the law. And he would say, it's a reasonable enough answer, but what if I were to tell you your job is to protect civil rights? Now, that encompasses enforcing the law, but it's a bigger job, it's a harder job. It's a job that's harder than they think, but it gives them room, it gives them permission even to treat people with dignity. Now, I will submit that our jobs are harder than we think. Our jobs are not simply to design cool shit. And we need to find a way to define our jobs in a way that lets us be more human to each other. And there are people working on this now. So Mike Montero at Mule Design created this little red book of design ethics that's sort of like a first do no harm for designers. And you can see some basic, you know, rules in there and a code of ethics that we can start to adopt. The Markkula Center for Applied Ethics has a fantastic sort of framework for ethical decision-making that you can kind of use and walk through different ways of thinking through a design decision, right? So which option will produce the most good and do the least harm, right? Which option best respects the rights of all who have a stake, right? These can become part of the status quo of design thinking. Another one I love is called the Tarot Cards of Tech. And it's basically a website you can go to and you can kind of see all these cards and flip them over and get really interesting questions to ask yourself about the product you're designing. So here's one about how might cultural habits change how your product is used and how might your product change cultural habits. Now, if Twitter had asked themselves these questions before they launched, we would have a very different world right now. Another fun one along those lines is called 52 UX Cards to Discover Cognitive Biases, right? So it's a great intersection. And so you can print these out. And the great thing about it is if you go to this website, they actually have exercises and workshops you can use these cards with. If you want to think about it more from a design pattern or design system perspective, there's this thing called Humane by Design. And it's really good at kind of highlighting different ethical considerations in the way that you design pages, right? So finite, right? Should you really have an endless scroll or should you cut people off at a certain point? Like things like that. It's also beautifully designed just as a website. So I highly recommend you check this one out too. We can even see this playing out in the world of software engineering, right? So the Never Again Pledge came out around the time when people were being asked to do very unethical things with data. I mean, as it turns out, we've been being asked to use unethical things with data for decades now, but the most recent wave of that spurred the Never Again Pledge. And it's basically software engineers getting together and saying, hey, look, here are things that we will not do when it comes to data. And it's a lot around like invasions of privacy. It's a lot around using data for unethical things. Like separating people from their kids, because someone has to write that database, right? And some of the ways we've seen this manifest is in things like Project Maven, right? So Google had this thing called Project Maven, and it was basically a battlefield AI, and a whole bunch of software engineers at Google said, yeah, we didn't get into this business to build weapons, so we're gonna opt out, right? And if you stay down this path, we are going to go on strike, we are gonna leave, we're gonna quit. And Google backed down. They backed away from a $250 million project. And then they turned right around and did Dragonfly, which is censored search in China. This one is still being fought out and Google's like hiring union busters now. But you can see that people are starting to turn to collective action, right? To make their voices heard. And again, define their jobs as designers to have this moral component as well as a I design cool stuff component. By the way, it still blows my mind that people actually, like who comes up with these James Bond villain names for things like Project Maven, Dragonfly, like some human adult actually wrote that in an email? We must rapidly begin the shift from a thing-oriented society to a person-oriented society. When machines and computers, profit motives, and property rights are considered more important than people, the giant triplets of racism, materialism, and militarism are incapable of being conquered. Now, this is not some software guru at a TED Talk. This is Martin Luther King Jr., right? 50 years ago, he saw this, and it's only more true today. So what I will ask us now on this call is, how might we define our jobs in a way that lets us be more human to each other? Thank you.
Ooh, that was great. Thank you, David. So wonderful and so many resources. I know I've had a couple people chatting that they're looking forward to getting the resources. So let's open up for Q&A. I neglected to say at the beginning, we'd love to call on you to ask your question, but if you aren't able to, you know, for some reason you prefer that we ask it for you, then that's totally fine. So I'm gonna, let's see. Well, Matt asked the question, is anyone not influenced by cognitive bias or less influenced? Matt, do you want to say your question or should I do it for you? Let me search for you and I can unmute you. Go ahead. Oh. All right, we'll just ask the question. So Matt's asking, David, are children under a certain age or any type of neuroatypical people, they have less of these bias than other people?
So the children question, sadly, no. They've found gender bias in like infants. It's really just kind of just terrifying. However, on that point, One thing that my wife and I have started doing is, if you go back to the little pattern thing, right? So there was a time when our kid, who I think was like 5 or 6 at the time, was asking us a question about female scientists. And between the two of us, and my wife, by the way, is in fact a female scientist, between the two of us, we can only come up with like 3 or 4 famous female scientists. And we're like, okay, this is a problem. So we bought this book that's basically page after page of female scientists. And we would read him one a night. And the idea was to set up a pattern, right? Female equals scientist, scientist equals female, right? And so I think it's a good time to try to start setting those patterns when people are young, but they are no less susceptible to some of these biases. Now, what you say about neuroatypical is interesting, right? Because one of the consistent things you see for some biases, so one of them would be optimism bias. And optimism bias is basically how, you know, 50% of marriages end in divorce, but if you ask any married couple if they're gonna get divorced, they say no, right? Like, what are the odds? And they're like, oh, like, 0% or 1%, or everyone thinks they're an above average driver. So that's optimism bias. People who suffer from depression generally don't have that. People who suffer from depression basically correct to normal. So they actually have a very, you know, in that sense, you know, when they're not catastrophizing, do actually, when they're asked questions like that, have a pretty realistic setting for that. And that plays out in a few other biases where you'll see that people who suffer from depression actually either normalize or over-index the other way. Because there's some biases, frankly, that are actually sort of healthy, even if they're delusional. Like you wouldn't get out of bed in the morning if you didn't have this bias. but people who suffer from depression, like, don't index in the other direction. So there are some neuroatypical people who will have it'll manifest differently for them than it does for people. And in fact, sometimes not having that bias is a diagnostic for you might be suffering from depression.
Great, thank you. One person asked for the author of the book you cited, Thinking Too Fast, and it is Daniel Kahneman.
It'll be in the resources sheet. I definitely cited that one because it's amazing.
Great. Danielle has a question. Let me see if I can. Danielle, would you like to say your question?
Hi, can you guys hear me?
Yep.
Yeah, so you talked a little bit about it, but I'm curious about your thoughts on how content strategy and design can actually be used to help people become more aware of their cognitive biases with the goal of being able to transform them. And I'm thinking of insights from cognitive behavioral therapy, which empowers us to, you know, recognize our thoughts and emotional patterns as part of the healing and growth process.
No, that makes a lot of sense. So I think there's a distinction between becoming aware and transforming, right? But I do think that there are things you can do to make you aware of behaviors, right? So one thing, for example, is Zoom calls, right? And I would love to institute a feature on Zoom that says, okay, this is going to be an hour meeting and we're going to allot everyone on this, and there's like 6 people on the call, we're going to allot everyone 10 minutes of speaking time, right? And you can even see it like on your little monitor, like being used up the more you speak, right? And the idea there is I'm making visible who's dominating the conversation and who's not, right? Who's being allowed to speak and who isn't being allowed to speak, right? And that's a way of making you aware that, because if you ask people after a meeting, were you aware you were the only person talking for most of that meeting? They'll have no idea, right? But if I can make you aware of certain behaviors, right? Oh, okay, all of a sudden. You see this actually playing out. A lot of dieting apps try to do this. So I had an app that sort of like helps record like how many carbs you're having in a day. And it's like the first few days you use it, you're like, oh my God, that's how much I'm eating, right? And again, it's not something you're conscious of. So using design or content strategy to make you conscious of things that you weren't conscious of is actually a pretty old art, but I think we've become more sophisticated about how we're using it. The actual transforming part is a little harder because that, one of the things that I've seen discussed a lot in terms of the paradigm for changing cognitive bias, because you never really get rid of it, because you need those mental shortcuts to survive. It's more about being aware of it and spending your ability to think slowly more accurately, right? So the idea is that you only have so much capacity for thinking slowly about things in any given day. So you don't want to waste it. It's called decision fatigue. You don't want to waste it on unimportant decisions. So again, if I can kind of make you aware of when you're doing that, but it's also true that you can expand that ability like a muscle. It's like maybe I can only make 5 quality decisions a day, but if I work on it, I can make 6 or 7. And the way generally people are saying you can do that is through mindfulness and meditation. That's a good way to stretch that muscle. Again, to get back to the cognitive behavioral therapy a bit. So I think there are ways, once you're aware of that, and maybe it's a two-step process of, let me make you aware of the behavior. Okay, now let's talk about ways to work on mindfulness so you're more careful. And it's like, oh, generally you don't think about the decision very much, but it causes harm when you don't. So let's make you aware that you should, right, be more careful about this decision, and basically slow you down. And that is actually, sorry, it's a roundabout way because I'm thinking a lot of it, but that is something I do talk about a bit in the book around slowing down behavior as a way of mitigating bias. So you're used to as designers thinking very much about, oh, it's gotta be frictionless, right? The problem with frictionless is that is like catnip to cognitive bias, right? Frictionless means I'm thinking faster, which means I'm thinking poorly. So you see companies like Patagonia who have very slow content experiences and relatively slow buying experiences because they don't want you buying something you don't want. They don't want you returning it and then doubling the carbon footprint of that thing because they're very environmentally oriented. So they try to slow down that experience so that when you do buy something, you mean it. So I do think there are design things you can do to slow people down in the interests of that. Does any of that answer your question? I feel like I'm rambling just a bit.
No, it is starting to answer my question. The transformative piece is what I'm really interested in.
Yeah.
And it's a complicated one, transforming behavior.
Yeah, and transforming behavior is the long game, right?
Yeah.
I'll give you another example, right? So if I talk about blind resumes, like blind resumes are great, but they're not the end all be all, right? Because even if everybody in the world had blind resumes going, the pool of people I would be choosing from for that web development job would still be heavily biased towards white male. Because the hoops you have to jump through societally to get to that level are very heavily biased against women, against people of color. Mm-hmm. So if you don't fix that, all the blind resumes in the world won't matter, right? And that fixing is a very long game. I'm talking about teaching my son about bias at 10. That's not gonna benefit society for another 10 years, right? Like, and it has to be not just my son, but like everybody's kids, right? So I think the behavior change aspect on the personal level and at the societal level is very much the long game, which doesn't mean we shouldn't do it, but we shouldn't expect it anytime soon.
Right, and there are lots of ways. Thank you.
Sure.
We have someone with their hand up. Donald, go ahead. See, unmute, there you go. See, I'm trying to unmute you. There you go.
I believe the economics of Temple.
Could you start over, Donald? Because I think we missed the beginning.
Okay, I teach behavioral economics at Temple. Mm. And so I'm delighted to see that you're going to give out the video and the slides. My question to you is whether, in terms of cognitive biases, whether people over, say, 40 are almost impossible to change compared to people under 40. And that will have implications both for teaching our students and for policy issues in the world at large.
That is a really good question.
It's a fundamental question.
No, it is.
In the universe.
Yeah, totally. And it's the old dog new tricks question, right? I think if I had to, based on the data I have already, which is not even a little bit complete, I would say probably the factors involved there are probably not very consistent, right? So one of the questions I get asked a lot is, are cognitive biases consistent across all sort of parameters, right? Generally, yes. The only parameters I've seen where, you are manifesting this fundamentally differently is either the neuroatypical things we were talking about before, so depression can be a big factor there, or culture. If you live in a collectivist culture, there are a ton of biases that you are not gonna suffer from or suffer less from, right? Age has not generally been the thing. And the few times I have sort of looked at biases and say, does this vary over age? Sometimes it gets worse, right? And intelligence, right? Really, really smart people, experts in their field, are just as susceptible to people who are total novices in that field, right? You have people making lawyers making legal decisions that are just as biased as people who know nothing about the law, right? So, and if you want to sort of equate age with experience in that scenario, then no, I don't think there really is much, you know, difference. That having been said, I know people who, as they got older, got more liberal. I know people who, as they got older, got way more conservative, right? I feel like the factors that determine how age is going to influence your malleability, your cognitive flexibility, are probably myriad and come down basically to more than age, which is a long-winded way of saying, I can't be sure older people are harder to teach. I think the questions you have to ask to determine that, age can only be one of those questions, right? It's going to be a lot of life experience. It's going to be how much have you experienced in a certain time period? Basically, have you ever left your town, right? Have you ever held more than one job? How many people have you met in your life? Like, I think it's going to be more things like that. But I've seen no data to indicate to me that older generations are going to be any more or less easier to teach than younger generations. I think you have a lot of more unwork to do if they've spent their whole life looking at the same pattern over and over again. That's definitely true. But sort of definitively, oh, just let's just not even bother. That I can't say for sure. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you. It really does. And it gives me hope.
Oh, yeah. And just so you know, like, behavioral economics is where this all started for me. I read Dan Ariely's Predictably Irrational. Like, and for those of you who don't know, and I actually begin my book talking about behavioral economics as a way of, like, the way that behavioral economics kind of opened up economics to be more, well, real and match better to real life. Like, this is sort of my attempt to sort of make design match better to, like, behavioral design match better to real life as well. It's a similar kind of prospect. So thank you for your work.
We have a question from Alan. He says, successful design often involves having a passion for an idea. How do you balance passion with bias?
That is a great question. I think that passion is great. There's two things there. I think one, passion is great for pushing through a difficult thing, because even coming up with a biased design is difficult, right? Because design is difficult, right? And passion is great for just working through stuff that's gonna take a long time and that otherwise you would say, forget this, I'm gonna go watch Netflix, right? Finishing my book, right? That was tough, right? And the passion that kind of got me through that first draft, right? Where I'm just word vomiting all over the page and just getting it all out there, right? That's passion. That's me, like, losing track of time. But the second draft, right? That's when I had to start fact checking. That's when I had to start, like, doing research, really difficult research that wasn't fun, frankly. But I did it. And I feel like this is a more personal anecdote, but I feel like for me, that was part of the passion, keying into the values part of the passion, right? So there's passion, but then there's values. And one of the things I valued was, I want this book to be true. I want it to actually be right. So the passion around wanting it to be right, I kind of, like, I don't know, redirected that passion to, I need to question everything I just wrote if I actually believe in what I just wrote. So that was part of it. It's sort of just being able to direct that passion to the right thing at the right time. So there's that first round of the blue team, if you will, the passion around, I just need to get the idea down on paper. But then the red team passions around, I believe in my heart that this, if this idea isn't right, it's not worth doing. It's going to cause harm, right? So let me add passion to that. The other piece of that, though, frankly, is getting other people in the room who have different passions, right? So any one person definitely is going to have passions, definitely do that thing. But if you get other people in the room with competing passions or with different passions, as long as everyone's being intellectually honest, that's the best, right? Because then I can say, hey, I have this idea, but I'm married to it. I need someone who isn't as in love with it to look at it now and who has a passion for fact-checking, who has a passion for finding the holes and finding the potential things that might cause harm. I need that person in the room now. I think that's an even better way to sort of leverage others' passion so that your own passion doesn't kind of overwhelm the project and then again, potentially cause harm.
Great, thank you. We have Rick with the question. Go ahead, Rick.
Can you hear me?
Yep.
Good. My question is, you've been talking about cognitive bias at sort of the individual level. I wonder what things you would do to help it at the societal level.
Sure. So at the societal level is where we start to talk about a very long game. And I think that this is where representation matters, right? So, and this is theory, but the example I want to give you is kind of along those lines. I think that the greatest contribution Obama gave culturally was being a Black man on the news every single night who was not either a criminal or a... and what I mean by that is, growing up Black, right, watching the news, if you saw a Black person on the news, those were pretty much usually your options, right? My son was born December of 2008, which meant for the first 8 years of his life, the powerful man on the planet was black. To the point where, when we got to the election of 2016 and Hillary was running, he actually came to us and said something like, "Is Hillary a black?" Which, after we corrected his grammar, right, we asked him, "Why did you ask that?" And for him, that's the default. Of course, anybody running for president would be black because the most powerful person was black, right? But that pattern setting, right? Now, the reason I think that's important is because I don't think you get Black Lives Matter to the same degree you did if the president isn't black, and here's why. It wasn't like black people weren't getting shot by the police before Black Lives Matter or before Obama. Before Obama, it wasn't such cognitive dissonance, right? Because again, the only pattern I saw for black people was criminals or celebrities. So in a way, of course they should be getting shot by the police because that's what the pattern is, right? When that pattern gets broken by the most powerful man in the world being on TV all the time as a black man, all of a sudden it's like, well, wait, that black man's the most powerful person in the world. Should we really be shooting black people, right? That dissonance, and that's at a societal level, right? We can talk about representation of LGBTQ in culture, right? We can talk about how things that have moved that seemed unmovable, and part of that is through pop culture and storytelling. So when I think about it at the societal level, those are the things I can kind of point to. There's also major, major economic shifts that happen as well. So when you throw a lot of money towards something, right, you start to see big societal shifts. But that's when, again, it's what is setting that pattern and what's setting that example for me to look to and make decisions based on. So yeah, if we're talking about the societal level, it is probably a long game. And that's if you're really, really focused, right? So think on the order of decades, not months. And it's probably through things like storytelling and culture and things that we already share at a societal level.
Great, thank you. Hillary wrote a question in the Q&A. Hillary, would you like to say your question or would you like me to read it for you? Let's see, I'll unmute you for a second in case you do want to say it.
Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yep, mm-hmm.
So hi, I'm Hillary Sunderland, and I work for a healthcare insurance company right now doing digital accessibility, so making websites and digital properties accessible for people with disabilities. So I work with a lot of designers. How do I get my designers to drop their able-bodied biases when they're designing? Do you have any tips and strategies for that?
So, and I am by no means an accessibility expert. I will point you to Mikey Illigan as like...
Okay.
The best person to talk to about this, but one thing that comes to mind is, so I had to get my pupils dilated a few months ago for a thing, and after that they were like, okay, you can go to work now and like you can drive. I'm like, really? Okay. And you can, right? So I went to work, and then I got to work and I'm like, I can't really see my computer screen, everything is way too tiny. So I blew up everything, right? Because there are some apps and there are some websites where you can just make the screen hella big, right? And just look at a little bit of it at a time. And it's funny, two things. One is I found out who my friends are that day, because some websites don't do that. And some phone apps are terrible at that and others are great at it, right? So I very quickly became very concerned with which sites were accessible, at least in that way, and which sites weren't. And I also realized, okay, this is me getting a very, 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 very tiny taste of one very, very thin strand of accessibility, and it is utterly changing my whole day, right? So there are little things like the, I don't know what it's called, the pinhole test, where you literally like just take a piece of cardboard or just move your hand like to make a little like telescope shape, right? So that you can only see a little bit of the screen at a time. I actually did this as like an accessibility project for like kids once to get them to, you know, hey, this is what Minecraft looks like when you can only see this much of the screen, right? How would you design it differently if that was the case? But experiencing it, like I'm very long-winded way of saying, just get them to experience it in some small way, so they can start to think about it that way, because they are designing based on their experience. So as much as you can get them to experience something else, it begins to build empathy. That's the one solution I know of. And I say that like hesitantly because I know there are far better people to talk to about that particular thing. Like I said, Mikey Illigan is a genius with this, but I know for me at least, just experiencing it for a few hours utterly changed like, you know, my understanding.
That was great. Thank you. That definitely lines up with some of the strategies we've been implementing. So we have done that straw test pinprick that you mentioned. So that's great. Thank you.
Great. Thanks. Swan has a question. Swan, would you like to say that, or would you like me to say it for you? Let me just unmute you real quick in case you'd like to speak.
No, you can. Well, much of the you can go ahead. You can put it through. That's fine.
Okay. Yeah. No problem. So he says, much of your design context centers around the world of IT or related realms. However, design encompasses and is integral to a wide range of activities. How have you considered these contexts in things like city planning or architecture and engineering or product design?
Oh my God. So I do have a little bit of the book where I talk about spatial design, like the design of human spaces, which begins to lean very slightly into urban design and urban planning, right? And the design of more, you know, bigger spaces. But there's a great anecdote from a friend of mine who was working in public health, and her job was to help decide on the funding for a vulnerable population in a major metropolitan city. I'm being cagey here because I can't give all the details. But one of the things she had to do, which is a problem I think a lot of us can relate to, is the people spending the money, every time it came time to decide how to spend the money, did it the same way they did it the year before, but the needs were changing, right? So this growing need here wasn't getting any funding, and this thing that had already been properly funded was kept getting funding. And there were a lot of different design elements, partially the design of the meeting itself, but then also the design of the physical space the meeting took place in, that were brought into play to A, get people to be more human to each other, because these were very tense, difficult human decisions to make. And the more you think about money, the less human you tend to get. B, to get people to be and feel more collaborative and creative, right? Because you're not gonna change the way you do things if you don't feel creative. So there were a host of different things, but a few of the key things were only 50 people ever showed up to this meeting, but there was seating for 100, and so you could not move around the room. So they got rid of half the chairs, so all of a sudden you can move around the room. And when you don't feel confined, you feel more creative. They made sure there was more access to light. There were these big giant windows, but you couldn't get to them before, so they made sure that space was near the windows so people could get like comfy chairs to sit in there. My favorite little spatial tweak was a coat rack. There was a coat rack in the back of the room that nobody ever used. So they took it, they moved it to the front of the room, and even then people wouldn't use it. So they took some of their own work sweaters and put them up on there to kind of seat it. And then when people saw that, they started using the coat rack. The reason this is important is because the coat rack being there made it feel like this was a space used by human beings. When you communicate that, right? You communicate this is a space where you can be a human being. And again, when you're making those kinds of decisions, it's extremely important that you feel like you can be open, that you can feel safe. You don't feel confined. You don't feel like you're in a space made for robots. Like, I don't know how many of you have ever been in a conference space or like a meeting room that feels like it was really built for robots, not people. And it changes the way you behave. And there's even little things like if you have a briefcase in a room where you're having like a meeting, people will act more competitively than if you replace that briefcase with a backpack. So there are definitely non-digital aspects to all of this that are really dealing with the same biases, but in a non-digital context. So the book doesn't really focus on that per se, because the general audience is people working in kind of more web design-y things. That having been said, there are definitely, you are correct, these things apply to the design of anything, including physical spaces, urban spaces, and product engineering, all of that.
Great. Swan had also asked, he liked the red team, blue team idea, and he's promoted the pre-mortem concept in his industry. People seem receptive, he says, but unsure how to engage. So how do you, you know, bridge that? We have an idea, you know, we actually want to do this, but maybe if it seems silly or it seems like it's going to take up time, how do you actually get people to commit to changing their practices?
You have to budget for it. Like, it has to be part of the project plan. I mean, I honestly had the same discussion for years in the industry around just not even pre-mortems, but retrospectives, right? Like, can we at least learn from the project we just did? Because, you know, you work in this industry, it's like, okay, let's move on to the next thing. There's no time to learn. We got to move on to the next thing. We got to make money, right? And retrospectives don't make money. I can't, they're not billable, right? And eventually people came to understand, oh yeah, we will make more money if we stop making the same mistakes. and they actually will build in then into the actual project plan. At least in my industry or my corner of the world, something is real once it's actually in the budget, right? Once it's actually in the project plan and we say, we're gonna set aside this much time, which means this much budget for the retrospective. You could do the same thing around the pre-mortem. You could do the same thing around the red team, blue team. And we'll say, oh, hey, it's time to do a new project. Okay, one of the first questions then should be, if you're taking it seriously, great, when should we bring in the red team, right? This is when we should do the kickoff. This is when we should do the first sprint. This is when we should do that. And this is when we should do the red team, right? It literally needs to be in the time, in the timesheet, in the budget. People need to be allocated and say, okay, guess what? I'm gonna put this in your timesheet for the week of whatever. Like, people will take it seriously when it's in, when it's written down, when it's written down in a place that matters, honestly. That and just any cultural biases around wanting to be nice and not wanting to be critical of other people's work. Some places have that, some places don't, but that's the other hurdle you might find difficult to get around. It's like, no, I'm giving you permission. I'm giving you a mandate to tear this apart, go.
Okay, thank you. We have a question from Tim. Tim, would you like me to ask your question, or would you like to ask it?
Yeah, you can ask.
Okay, no problem. So Tim says, bias is omnipresent, right down to what we think are intuitive design choices. Didn't the Obama campaign raise an additional $60 million in contributions based on using a blue call to action button rather than the red button? We all have biases and we need to acknowledge that we may not be right. So we need to test and experiment constantly.
Yes. And that sounds true. I don't remember specifically that, but that actually sounds true. In fact, red and blue are really interesting color wise. Just side anecdote. There's an experiment where you have people do brainstorming tasks or detail oriented tasks like proofreading. If you do a brainstorming task with a blue background, people came up with twice as many ideas than a red background. If you're doing a proofreading task against a red background, you catch 30% more errors than if you do it against a blue background. So color, yes, absolutely. I think all of those things are true, and you have to test yourself. But I think more than that, you have to think about the quality control of decision-making. Right? Think of like how decisions get made at your company. Think about how decisions get made for your design, about all of that. And there's sort of like this notion of testing because, you know, you want to see how different biases are going to play out. But there's also the notion of testing each other even before that design ships, right? And again, I keep coming back to this notion of additional perspectives. I think that's one of the most powerful things you can bring into any decision-making process is to say the same way that if we're doing code, we have a QA team who isn't the coders, who's going to come in and test everything. For your decision-making processes, have the same thing. Have a bunch of people, whether it's a red team, blue team paradigm, whether it's some other paradigm, but people who are good at analyzing things and more importantly, are coming with a different perspective to the table to look at what you're doing. And by different perspective, I mean like literally they didn't go to college, right? Or they don't make as much money as you do, or they look different than you do, or they have more importantly, have a different lived experience than you. One of the most exciting things happening in design right now is called participatory design. City of Philadelphia has been doing this. They had a project with the Office of Homeless Services here where they flipped the paradigm around who they were beholden to. And so instead of saying, okay, the public officials who hired us are the ones we have to make happy, no, the people who are experiencing homelessness and the people who are servicing those people, that's who we need to make happy. And that's who we're gonna check in with. That's who we're gonna like be beholden to. And that's the people we're gonna say, hey, what you decide, we will implement. Right? Now think about that from a power dynamic perspective. That never happens. The public never actually gets to decide what gets implemented. Some public official does, some agency does. So that approach to design brings in, and not just brings in, but values, that's the key difference, gives power to completely different perspectives, right? Than you would normally get in a design project. So I think that's the other element of kind of what you're talking about. Like there's the testing, which I think is important, but I think the multiple perspectives and often unheard perspectives that are going to be impacted by this, whatever you're working on. That's the other element that I think where bias, you're actually leveraging good bias.
Very interesting. I always thought it was interesting when I had a map of the world with all the flags of the different countries, and you know, a strong majority of them have red in them. So something very, you know, meaningful to us as a species about red. Yeah. Any other questions? I think I've got all of them in the Q&A, and I've been looking at the chat too. Anyone else have something they'd like to ask? You can put your hand up or chat me, and I can try to unmute you. You good? Okay, so Renee asks, what's the best way to persuade a team with different backgrounds to be unbiased?
So it's interesting. It's interesting you say that, because if they, depending on the different backgrounds, I might not want them to be unbiased. I might want them to bring their biases to the thing. And just real quick, I'm dropping in the chat here, if you want to like chat with me at some point, virtual coffee, and if you want to keep updated on the book, those are some links there for you to play with. But yeah, so depending on what those biases are, I might actually want them to bring them, as long as they're aware of them. And as long as we can kind of say, okay, I'm going to take your comment with this grain of salt, and I'm going to take your comment with this grain of salt. But if they're complementary biases, that can actually be good. So I kind of guess it depends on the bias. One thing I do find helpful is to get people to focus on one goal. So for example, I was working with a pharmaceutical company, and there was a legal team who had their own set of biases and their own kind of mission. And then there was a design team, a brand team, that had kind of had their own biases and their own mission. And both of them were bringing, you know, problematic issues to this particular website we were working on, right? So the legal team was so strict that it took like 6 months to change anything. And the brand team was so interested in selling the product that they were putting stuff on the website that was actually getting in the way of the user completing their task. So to bring them in a room and to get them to align, one of the things we did at the outset, like even in the kickoff, was say, well, what are we really here for? And to their credit, it wasn't just make money. Their mission was, we want to improve patient outcomes, which is a great mission, right? And so we basically just kept reminding of that over and over again. So when it came time to talk to the legal team, who had their bias around, you know, protecting themselves, we could say, okay, well, what's our mission here? Like, what's your job? Like, going back to that, what is your job? What's your job? And they would say, well, to keep us from getting sued. And we could say, okay, that's important, but what if I told you our job was to improve patient outcomes? Now, we can improve patient outcomes if we get sued, but if we're so strict that it takes 6 months to launch anything, we also can't improve patient outcomes. And it's like, oh, okay. And then with the brand team, we can say, okay, well, what's your job? And they can say, oh, well, to sell these products. And it's like, what if I told you our job was to improve patient outcomes? Now, that requires selling products, but if we do it in a way that keeps people from using the products, well, we're not going to improve patient outcomes, right? So coming from these very different biases, we were able to sort of get them to align to, okay, the higher purpose, right, that they're really trying to achieve. And we had these meetings where like the legal team and the brand team, who usually were at each other's throats, were sitting there with like stickies putting together web pages based on the notion of how do we improve patient outcomes. So I think that can be a powerful way. So when the biases aren't helping, when they're actually destructive, I think aligning on a common goal can be a good way to sort of like get them to serve, you know, a greater master.
Great, thank you. Any final questions for Dave? We really appreciate all you staying on and chatting with us. Anyone else? Okay, I'm not seeing any notifications. So thank you so much for attending. David, thank you so much for an amazing presentation. It's clear that everyone found it very interesting. And we're going to send out the slide deck along with Dave's resources and the recording either today or Monday. So watch for that. And feel free to forward it to anyone who you think might be interested in it. All right. Thank you so much, everyone. Again, thank you, David. And have a great weekend. Enjoy hopefully better weather, and I look forward to seeing you. We have some other upcoming webinars that you'll be invited to, so hopefully we'll see you on one of those. Thanks a lot.
Thanks.
Bye-bye. All right, looks like there's still some people on, but I'm going to close out the meeting. If anybody does, I'll send my email out for if anyone would like to contact me about anything or has any questions. And again, we're going to send out the recording and the slides and other information either today or Monday. Thanks a lot.